Good morning. Oh, all right. Upcoming events. The communion and stewardship meditation schedule is available in the foyer for pickup. I think we're picking up four new people this year, so I think that'll be good. Also, the Christmas card mailbox is in the foyer. Christmas Eve worship is on Christmas Eve, shocking, 6 p.m. Junior choir rehearsals will start after the beginning of the new year. Senior Saints dinner is February 17th at noon, and then the wild game feed on the 24th of February as well. Also, any man desiring to serve as an elder or deacon may make his desire known to one of the elders today. Is the deadline for that currently. We have Bill Taylor and Rick Nolan running for deacon or elder, and Eric Davis and Jim White for deacon. So you'll be asked to approve these people next week. No, that's not right. The 10th. Yes, that is right. Next week. Yeah, 3 plus 7, 10. Okay. All right. Also, I have a card here. Thank you so much for all the gifts for baby Paisley. We are so grateful to have so many people in our lives that care about us and our growing family. We appreciate you all so much, Garrett and Taylor LeMasters. So, baby's still doing fine, I assume. Good, good, good. All right. All right, let's be standing, please. Romans 8:28, join with me, please. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you. Lord, thank you for giving us the opportunity to be able to come here this morning and praise you and worship you, Lord. Lord, help us to love you. Lord, we have all kind of reasons to do that, Lord. You bless us. You watch after us. Lord, most of all, you died for our sins. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Lord, right now we just want to worship and praise you, focus on you, do our best to give you the honor and glory that you deserve. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Who's ready to sing "Come On, Ring Those Bells"? Well, I haven't been able to sing for really quite a while, so I'm really happy and thankful to be able to be up here this morning. So is Kathy here? Did Kathy get to come? Okay. You know, I think sometimes we get so caught up in getting ready for Christmas that we forget what we're celebrating. But we're not going to. We're going to sing this fun song, and we're going to sing, and we're going to praise, and we're going to celebrate Jesus, the one that came to save us all.
Everybody likes to take a holiday, and everybody likes to take a rest. Spending time together with the family, sharing lots of love and happiness. Come on, ring those bells, light the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, He was born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells, and everybody say, Jesus, we remember this your birthday. Celebrations come because of something good. Celebrations we love to recall. Well, Mary had a baby boy in Bethlehem. Greatest celebration of them all. Come on, ring those bells, light the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, He was born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells, and everybody say, Jesus, we remember this your birthday. Come on, ring those bells, light the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, He was born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells, and everybody say, Jesus, we remember this your birthday.
Everybody, now come on, ring those bells,
light the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, He's born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells, and everybody say, Jesus, we remember this your birthday. Jesus, we remember this your birthday.
It's Christmas.
And blessings. Praise the Lord, Nancy was able to sing. Anybody else got something they want to praise the Lord about? That they were blessed with?
I do, Jason.
Yes.
My foot's getting better.
All right.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for the prayer.
All right. That's not catching on. I don't see everybody wearing those. So. Yes.
I'm done.
No, Lynette's done with her masters. Praise the Lord. We're both grateful. Yes, Susie.
Two things today. Bonnie's another year older, and I'm not yet. Our family only has...
Praise the Lord for family. Praise the Lord for family. Anybody else? Yes, Jimmy.
Mom and Kelly's here today.
Oh, hi, Kelly.
Hi, Mom.
How's Joanne? You're hiding behind that guy there in front of you. Anybody else? Say again, George.
We're about to go to Brad and Burner for Thanksgiving.
Oh, good for you. Praise the Lord. And Lisa?
I got a good report back, and it was not my part.
All right. Good. All right. Hey, I went hunting with my brother and his boy and my grandson. We didn't shoot each other. We didn't shoot any deer either, but we didn't shoot each other. So praise the Lord. All right. Anybody else? All right. Actually, let me look on this list here first. Larry Kendall's got COVID. He's in the hospital. So let's be in prayer for Larry. Also, I got a text from Verna Hansel. Brad's mom is in the hospital for a cardiac observation, and Verna's mom is at the ER, and she doesn't know what's going on there. So let's be in prayer for them, both of those mothers and their situations. That's Bab Andis and Sue Barrow. Also, Gary Schwartz's brother-in-law passed away. I think Lee has been here, and I think has he sang here? I don't know, but does anybody know Lee's last name? I texted Gary, but he hadn't responded. So anyway, Gary Schwartz's brother-in-law. Also, Nancy Baker is in rehab. Edna Schau, she's in the hospital. She's a gal down at Lowell. And Tammy Reynolds has colon cancer and starts treatment on December 13th. Also, Maureen Welch, we all know, is improving. Austin Gagneau leaves for Ghana on the 5th. Wyatt?
Hokabor.
Thank you. Is that spelled correctly, Hokabor?
Yes.
Wow, okay. Good job, Dawn. He's back to school and doing well. Michael Hendershot will be induced on the 18th. OVCA upcoming retreat, pray for that. Good News Production, the video that you all paid for is going to be put out here pretty soon in India. 30 to 50 million people will be reached with that. Janet Smith is recovering from chemo and radiation. Also, Lynette has a doctor appointment Tuesday to get some results from a test, several tests she's had done. So be praying for good results there. Anybody else to add this morning? Yes, Dawn.
My dad's twin brother, Donnie Heisel, had a massive heart attack. He needed two stents, but he only gave him one. They wanted to do heart surgery, but he's not going in. So he's got one stent.
Okay, sorry about that.
He is home.
I had another page I forgot about. So, Micah Kaiser's got pneumonia. Donnie Heisel, massive heart attack. You're saying they're not going to be able to do surgery?
They're not doing open heart surgery. He's not strong enough.
Okay. And the family of Fred Skinner passed away. He was an elder down at Lowell Church. So let's be in prayer for that family. All right. Anybody else to add? Who's this?
Dee Ugly that sets with me.
Uh-huh. Okay.
She's still not good.
Okay. Yes.
My grandson, Jesse Siddle, he's on the prayer list, but he's on his second round of chemo, and my granddaughter told me this morning that he's not doing real good. So please pray for him. I'm sorry for...
Yeah, I'm gonna say that right now. I put it on here. I got too much stuff going on. Your grandson is?
Jesse Siddle.
Okay. Also, Mindy Conkler, she's got some pretty serious heart issues. They told her life expectancy is about a year. She's 49 years old, and this is your?
Daughter-in-law.
So let's be praying for her as well. Is there anybody else to add this morning? Bill Taylor. After we sing, would you offer up prayer for those on our list, please? Let's be standing, please.
Good morning. And following Jimmy White's greeting here this morning, the morning church, I love that. I told him I've heard his dad say that lots of times over the years, so I really appreciate that. This morning I want to talk about something I talk about every time for a little bit, but I'm not going to bore you with it. You know, we have a different offering that we had compared to the people that was under the law, which was a tithe. And people, this was a tithe that you paid it or else. We have to understand that a lot of that was because the Levites were not able to have land. So a lot of the tithes went to support the priests, the Levites. But I'm happy that as we look at the kind of the New Testament way of giving, which is, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless abundantly, so in all things, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. I'm happy. I don't know how I would have got along with the law. I probably would have broke it the first hour that I was, you know, under the law. But anyway, as we talked about Macedonian churches, and I know I said this before, these people were mostly Gentile Christians. And I think in my own mind that they didn't have the responsibilities and the things on their mind that Jewish Christians did. So I think there is more freedom in following God's way of doing things. But anyway, as we look at them, we look at their way of giving and giving so abundantly and so freely that they pleased. Paul even made a gesture to them how pleased he was with their type of giving. And actually, that's what I want to talk about today. It's giving beyond your normal giving. It's giving to the needs of others. And I started looking for scripture for this, and I found hundreds, at least 150 different scriptures, Old Testament, New Testament, that deals with giving to those who are in need. God is saying, if you give to people that is in need, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. There's a lot of promises that God has made. I say all of this for a reason this morning. We have a special need here in the church. The elders, we elders have been working with, and I want to open this need up to you as a congregation. And this need is a family, a single mother that has four children. The first names of these children will be on the back there on the list that I'm going to put out later. But we just ask that you'll use the example of the Macedonian churches, and you'll reach out to this family. The elders has already been helping the family some. But what we're asking you to do today is take one of the sheets that I'm going to put out there later, and make sure these four children have something for Christmas this year, something that we can help with. Before you make that decision, I'm asking that you will pray about it. I think that's the secret to all giving. Pray about it, ask God's guidance on it, and I'll guarantee that the money will be available, or gifts, or whatever you want to give. Remember, as you think about this time, you can't outgive God. You cannot do it. And I'll guarantee that you all will have a blessing that will be with these little children. The mother also is works every day. She works. She takes care of her family the best she can. But her dad has recovering from meningitis, so she's trying to take care of her dad and her four children. And I'm sure she could use a gas card or whatever you want to give for her would be appreciated. So if you take care of these four children, there's going to be a list in back of the four children, their ages. There are three girls, and of course the youngest one is a boy. So pray about it. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're so thankful for this opportunity to give, even beyond our offerings, even beyond what we think that we're capable of. Father, I believe that we, this congregation, will be like the Macedonian churches. We'll be able to give beyond our means, beyond what we're capable of doing, because you will be a part of it. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Now, all I'm saying is it's very unfair that I have to follow Miss Nancy. So whoever set me up, I'll remember this. Miss Nancy, next time she calls, I'm saying no. Forget it.
Excuse me, I shouldn't have done that, and you're here, pardon me. You know, I think that mountain climbers could save a lot of time and energy if they were to reach the summit of the mountain that they want to climb by helicopter. Do you agree with that? And I got to thinking about this. Ultramarathon runners, you know what an ultramarathon runner is? Does anyone here run a 5K? Anyone here ever run a 5K? I don't blame you either. You did? You dirty low. Are you serious? A 5K? Long time ago, okay, I was going to say. How about a half marathon? Anybody ever run a half marathon? You? That's right, I remember you doing it. You're not dumb enough to run a whole marathon, are you? I didn't think so. An ultramarathon is like 50 plus miles, right? And back in April, a gal by the name of Josiah Zardikowski, or I would say Josiah Smith, on the 7th day of April, 2023, she was in an ultramarathon run, 50 plus miles. This lady had already ran, like in 3 days, 250 some odd miles. Why? I don't know. But anyway, she was running, and she decided she couldn't finish it. So she hops in a car, in her friend's car. Her friend gives her a ride. During the ride, the friend is talking up her buddy, cheering her on and such. The lady decides, might as well finish the race. So after a while of being in the car, she gets out the race, finishes third. I'm in, man. That's the way to run a race, right? Right? So mountain climbers should ride a helicopter. Marathon runners, ultra marathon runners should call Uber, right? But that's not the ultimate purpose, is it? The ultimate purpose of this run, of this race that we're in, this journey that we are on, is conquest, not efficiency. So, Thad, I'd love to see you run a 5K now. I figure you will not get a PB. That's a personal best, by the way. But then again, maybe you might.
Probably get another HT.
An HT? Heart attack. Yeah. That was good, wasn't it, Holly? Thank you. The ultimate purpose of mountain climbing and ultramarathon running is, again, the conquest, not efficiency, how quickly you get it done. Sure, everybody wants to reach the goal, but the desire to do so by testing and deepening character and discipline and resolve. I mean, God could just create scientists and mathematicians and electricians and plumbers just from nothing. He could just pop them on the planet, but he doesn't. But he does create his children who take on those roles over a long process. And you just heard about Lynette's long process. I think it's great that Jason is married to a master. It's about time that happened. Likewise, God does not make us fully Christ-like the moment that we come to him, the moment that we surrender our lives to him, but it's gradual. He conforms us to the image of Christ gradually. As a matter of fact, Paul says it this way in 2 Corinthians 3, that we all with unveiled faces behold the glory of God, glory of the Lord, are being transformed from the same into the same image from one degree of glory to another. One degree, right? Not 10 degrees at one time, but one degree of glory to another. You see, in our spiritual lives, as in our professional lives, whether it's sports or hobbies included, we improve and we excel by handling failure and learning from it. And only in cultivating discipline, endurance, and patience do we actually find satisfaction and reward. All those qualities are most developed through some sort of suffering. Suffering will be your constant companion. So what do I say about that? Because if you're going to find God at the end of the year, at the end of the age, it's going to be you're going to find him at the end of yourself. So let me just offer a couple, three ideas here, how I think this comes together. First of all, let's talk about the all. God uses it all for our good and for his glory. God will use it all. Like teeth and pains and colicky babies, prostate issues, prostate cancers, various types of cancers, heart diseases, disunity in families, people apart from God. God can use it all for our good and his glory. And instead of just blaming doctors and drunk drivers and criminals for our suffering, we should actually stop and go, okay, I realize the neighborhood I live in a fallen world among fallen people who are broken, bust up, messed up. It's a circus out there. So where do I go? Well, I love the text in Romans 8:28. We recited earlier together. Some things that we are assured of, that we know, not left to guess. This will buoy us to remind ourselves that God can use all things for our good and his glory. And I know you've been through some nasty stuff, some horrible stuff. I wish I could snap my finger and make it go away, but I can't. All I can do is come alongside and walk with you. That's all we can do many times, is just come alongside and walk with one another. Amen. Scratch our head. Spit in the dirt if you have to. Fine. Kick up a pile of dirt. Just don't do the Bobby Knight and throw chairs, okay? I mean, there's all kinds of reactions that we have. But look, here's something that we can rest in. We know that for those who love God, you see the word all? All things work together for good. Does not say all things are good. All things are desirable. All things are pleasant. But all things will work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. And why do God's children undergo pressures, suffering, deadly peril? And Paul answers that in 2 Corinthians 1 when he says, indeed, look, we felt that we had received the sentence of death. We thought this is it for us. We're getting ready to walk the line. We're walking toward the light, right? This is it for us. We felt that we had received the sentence of death. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead. Do you realize that even if, and I hope God continues to impress upon me, even if I lose my mind more than I already have, if I lose my mind and I die a horrible death, the resurrection is still inevitable. It may be the ruination of this body or my earthly existence, but I have the promise of the resurrection. You see, a victim of a great evil once told me, and if I could give you the story, I won't, because it just would not be appropriate. I spoke to a victim of a great evil once. And the individual told me this and stopped me dead in my tracks, and I got to share it with you because it's so good. This individual said, I learned that God wasn't going to go down my checklist of happiness and fulfill it. I learned what it meant to surrender to His will before I wanted certain gifts from Him. I want Him. Is that not beautiful? Before I wanted certain gifts from Him, I want Him. So good, I think. You see, for turning us toward God, sometimes nothing works like suffering. C.S. Lewis is credited with saying these words, and I think they're right. Says God whispers to us in our pleasures, and He speaks in our conscience. He shouts in our pain. It's His megaphone to rouse a deaf world. God uses suffering, my friends, as my friend told me so eloquently. God uses suffering to bring me to the end of myself, that I'll lay myself at the feet of the cross. That's what you do with suffering. And it's worth any cost. You know, and I say these words not from a perch of a lofty, from a lofty philosophical perch, but in the crucible. In the crucible of walking with you through immense suffering, agonizing pain. This is not theory to us. And we sense not only God's presence, but also His purpose. So that leads me necessarily, I think, logically to this thought, and that is our suffering often includes discipline. It's not by happenstance, right? Our response to it is not happenstance. And if I'm going to find God, if I'm going to come to understand who He is, I've got to get to the end of me that I may have Him. I think for us to be transformed increasingly into Christ's likeness, I've got to have God's correction. As a matter of fact, Hebrews tells me, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 10 and 11 says that He disciplines us for our own good, that I may share in His holiness. You see, that's the only holiness I'll ever know, is His holiness. Because there is no good thing in me, and there ain't much good in you either, so don't start throwing rocks, right? There's no good thing in us. When Jesus came to the earth, He came and He became sin, so that you and I might become the righteousness of God through Him. That's the greatest deal in history. He disciplines us for our own good, that we may share in His holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields a peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who will be trained by it. And of course, God never punishes us. God never punishes us to atone for our sin. What He does do is He calls us to accept and not strive to repeat Christ's atonement. Because listen to what Isaiah says in Isaiah 53:5. He says these words, "He was wounded for our transgressions." What are you going to give to cover for your transgressions? Not a lick. "He was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And upon His shoulders, the chastisement that brought us peace, and by His stripes, we are healed." Receive that. See, He gives us a clear reason for his disciplining, and that is so that we may reflect Him adequately in a dark universe. Again, Lewis speaks of discipline this way. This is from his work, A Grief Observed. And he says, and I quote, suppose that what you are up against is a surgeon whose intentions are wholly good. The kinder and more conscientious he is, the more inexorably he will go on cutting. if he yielded to your entreaties, if he stopped before the operation was complete, all the pain up to that point would have been useless. And what do people mean when they say, I'm not afraid of God because I know he's good? Have they never been to a dentist? So good. Here's a third idea I'll share with you. Discipline's required. Here's the third thing. Suffering will reveal my personal idols. Now, before you start throwing rocks, everyone in this room, at heart, every one of us in this room, at heart, is an idol worshiper. That's the number one problem. And suffering exposes idols in our lives. It uncovers our trust in God's substitutes and declare our needs to transfer our trust to the one and only who can bear the weight. The only one that can act like a deity. Listen, don't believe me. Believe what the Word of God says. Proverbs 18, verses 10 and 11 tell us give us an accurate depiction of life, of us as humans. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Amen to that, right? The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Who can withstand him? Who is like him? There's no one like him, right? So we'd all agree with that. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. That makes sense, right? God is higher than all. He's above all. He's over all. He knows it all. He knows the beginning, the middle, and the end before it happens. He knows the good and the bad and the ugly about me, and yet loves me anyway. It's a good thing to run to. That would be smart, right? The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. Yeah, but the rich man, the man that thinks he's got it all together, the person who thinks more of himself than he ought, there's a lot of different ways that we can explain what a rich man is. It's not just someone that's flush with cash, right? A rich man's wealth is his strong city. And like a high wall, in his imagination. So God uses any means necessary to tear down whatever we hide behind. Our job, our reputation, our accomplishments, our material possessions, our potency. He strives to, he'll tear down whatever we hide behind because that's an imaginary wall. But anything less than God himself, to have anything less than God himself, I'm telling you, we're going to come up short. Look at what Jeremiah says in Jeremiah 2:13. Here's his commentary on society. Here's his commentary on culture. And I think it's apropos for us to consider this. God says, my people, those who know who I am, who are aware of my accomplishments, my people, not strangers, not my enemies, my people have committed two evils. They've decided they can do it all themselves, and they have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters. And what they've done is, the second thing is, they went out with their own two hands, and they've tried to carve out in stone. They have hewn out cisterns for themselves, and they're broken. They're broken cisterns that can hold no water. You see, we may imagine God as our genie who comes to do our bidding, but suffering wakes me up to the fact that I serve him and not he me. Diseases, accidents, natural disasters remind us of our extreme vulnerability. Life is out of our control. Trace and I killed a nice deer last Saturday with the granny van. It's amazing how fast or how slow your reaction time is driving about 111 miles an hour. It's like boom, boom, things happen, right? And I didn't intentionally set out to do it. As a matter of fact, it breaks my heart for my granny van. Things just pop up fast. We have very little control. And what I must do is relinquish the idol of control that causes me to believe that I can prevent all bad things from happening or correct their byproducts. Let me remind you, this world is not yours. Psalm 24:1 tells me who it belongs to. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell in it. I don't even belong to myself. That's what Paul says to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 16:19-20. Hey, you're not your own. You've been bought with a price. And that price is the price that God paid on the tree of Calvary and at the empty tomb at Golgotha. Jesus has title deed to my existence. So I should repeatedly tell the Lord, this house is yours, this body is yours, this vehicle is yours, this money I got is yours, my influence is yours, my job is yours. You own the title deed, you own the rights, you have the power of life and death in itself. And I think it becomes much easier to trust God when we understand that whatever he takes away belonged to him in the first place. You ever think about that? That's what Job says, Job 1. I appreciate his perspective. He says, look, naked, N-E-K-E-D. That's how it's said. Naked I came from my mother's womb. That's the way most children come. And naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord's taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Here's one final thing let me share with you real quick. I think it comes down to this. I think. At least I'm going to make best efforts. I'm going to endeavor to get this done. Because too much of me is not a good thing. When I'm emptied and God can fill, that's where the good things start to happen. So what I want to learn to do is to count it all joy. To count it all joy. You see, we come into this world needy, and guess what? We're likely to leave it the same way. We come into this world needy, and as we get older, we start to become needy again, right? Right? We go from vulnerability to strength to vulnerability. I mean, that's just the way it is. We come into the world needy, and we're going to leave it the same way. And without suffering, we quickly forget our neediness. If suffering seems too high a price for faith, it's because, I think, I've devalued or underestimated faith's value. James says it this way in James chapter 1. You know this text. Count it all joy. Reckon it. Like put it up in the bank. You got a ledger account. You're doing your QuickBooks or whatever you're doing, however you keep your stuff. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. Let her have her work. Let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. How in the world can we possibly obey this command, welcome difficulties, instead of resenting them? How? I think it's by trusting that God tells the truth when he says that these things are going to make me more Christ-like, to increase my endurance, to expand our ministry, to prepare me for eternal joy. So, perseverance through suffering for Christ's glory, I think, is the sure pathway to godliness. And I pray that our God of grace and kindness grant us peace and immerse us in his presence as we walk this road that we're on. And may he remind us both that he walked the road before us, and he presently walks the road with us now. Why else would I not surrender to him? So if I'm going to find God at the end of the year, beginning of the Christmas season, if I'm going to find God, I think I'm going to find him at the end of me. And I think it's a good place for that union to be found. If you're apart from Christ this morning, you've been looking for him, you've been reaching haphazardly for him. If you know that God raised him from the dead, you're halfway home. If you believe that in your heart, you're keeping good company. If you've not been united with him by faith into his death, into his burial and his resurrection, I want to offer you that invitation now. We invite you to come. We're going to stand, sing, take a few moments to give you an opportunity to respond. Good time to make a break. We'll invite you to come as we stand and sing. Let's do that together.
Thank you. thank you to whoever chose that last song. That was perfect. It's a perfect segue into this portion of our service. Something that we do every week, but my goal being up here is to make sure it's not a routine. It's something that we stop and think about in a serious way. This week, many of you know, was deer season, and we had a really interesting conversation with our three-year-old because in the moments, you know, they're putting on their blaze orange and they're running around the house with their toy guns, and somebody puts some air-filled deer antlers on their head, and we have all this fun. But one night going to bed, there was a very serious moment with this young fellow and his mother where he realized that the deer had to die. And he's with tears in his eyes, he said, "I don't want to die. I don't want to see my own blood." And it's comical because there was a moment there where he grasped what really happened. And it's not going to be clear how I tie this all in until I get into our scriptures here. So I'm in 2 Peter chapter 3. This is the Message translation. "Since everything here today might well be gone tomorrow, do you see how essential it is to live a holy life? Daily expect the day of God, eager for its arrival. The galaxies will burn up and the elements will melt down that day, but we'll hardly notice. We'll be looking the other way, ready for the promised new heavens and the promised new earth, all landscaped with righteousness. So, my dear friends, since this is what you have to look forward to, do your very best to be found living at your best in purity and peace." So this is the portion of the service where we do a few things. Number one, we recognize our own need for a Savior. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." One pastor that we are still connected with, but one pastor that we listen to every Sunday, he would say, "All means all, and that's all means." Everyone has sinned. We all need that Savior. The second thing that we do is we recognize with thanksgiving in our heart that we have that Savior in Jesus. Romans 5:8 says, "God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." The third thing that we do, or that we should do, it's kind of hard to do sometimes, is we experience the peace that transcends all human understanding. This is Philippians 4:6-8. And this is the Passion Translation. This isn't what I'm familiar with, but I really liked it. I just punched it into Google and it came up. So it says, "Don't be pulled in different directions or worried about a thing. Be saturated in prayer throughout each day, offering your faith-filled requests before God with overflowing gratitude. Tell him every detail of your life. Then God's wonderful peace that transcends human understanding will guard your heart and mind through Jesus Christ. Keep your thoughts continually fixed on all that is authentic, real, honorable, admirable, beautiful, and respectful, pure and holy, merciful and kind. And fasten your thoughts on every glorious work of God, praising him always." This is the hard part. Zach hit on it just a few moments ago. Part of recognizing the sacrifice of Jesus is relinquishing the fact that you don't need to be the atoning sacrifice. That was done for you. So this is the part of the service where we have faith like children. Let God wash your slate clean, so that on the day of judgment, on the day of God, we are found living our best in purity and in peace. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Jesus. He died and bled on a cross, paying our sin debt in full, now and forever, reconnecting us with you, Father. He was the propitiating sacrifice, the payment of all of our debts. Father, I pray that you'll renew each person in this room today. Give us faith like children to accept the reality of Jesus and what he's done for us, so that we can go out and be your hands and feet, be your church, show love to the world around us, be at peace. Father, instruct us in our hearts to what it means to live our best in purity and peace, I pray today. Amen.
Thank you.
Hey, Sy, Chubbs, way to be a good theologian, brother. Yeah, that's my buddy Chubbs. Aren't you grateful for those little minds like that and they catch stuff, right? So thank you, Chubbs, and thank you, Dr. Luke. You had the sense enough. You were able to go down there and scoop that up. Keep scooping, folks, because we're going to need each other more and more, and let's pick it up as we go along. And Tammy, it's fun watching you be a grandma. Don, how's being a grandma coming along? Is that okay? Wonderful, isn't it? I told you. Yeah, so anyway, yeah, it's a good thing. Let's love each other as God's loved us. And I bet you a dollar to a donut that we'll make an impact in this world if we will. If we'll get out of ourselves and more into Christ, we'll see the world in a different way. Let me pray. We'll call it a morning. We'll see you along about 6 this evening to come worship again, all right? Father, thank you. And you're the God of the universe, and we're not. Thank you that you never fail, you never falter, you never make a mistake. You will never, ever say, man, never saw that coming, and for that, I rest in your mercy and in your grace. Father, help us to seek your face, to realize that we are not the Redeemer, but you are, through the person of Jesus Christ. And may we find perfect peace in that reality as we live in this crazy, mixed up world. Bless us to that end, and it's in Christ I pray. Amen.
Share God's love this week.